Chapter 1. Three people running. It was perhaps approaching 11 in the morning, and most of the summer guests at the boarding house had gradually drifted out after breakfast to set up camp on the grass in front of the veranda. After several chilly days, the stagnating heat of summer had finally arrived. It had rained in the night, but the bad weather had cleared at around 7, and the sun had then sparkled the whole morning through, drying the grass and soil, steaming away the puddles and baking the roads hard and white. And now the summer guests rejoiced over the arrival at last of the great, driving summer, with its vast abundance of heat. And so they had laid themselves out in the baking sun, lay prostrate now, scattered in the high grass, squinting at the quivering light, and lending an ear to the whisper out at sea. They listened for the summer breeze, which prised itself loose out in the ocean and glided over the rocky crests, penetrating the spruce forest, which sapped its feeble strength, and faltering over the meadows where it barely managed to shake the grass and tickle the faces of the resting people. From where I lay in the grass, I had a glimpse of a white muslin bodice, a woman's golden neck and hair, slowly stirring. But if I turned my head a trifle, my gaze fell upon the hotel awning, its bright red stripes set in charming disarray by the play of the sunbeams. Five people lay in the grass around me. All were seemingly asleep, although none were sleeping. Of the white-clad lady to my left, I knew that she was resting her face in both hands and had a novel open before her, but not once did I hear her turn its pages. And nobody said a word. We were all compelled to absolute inactivity and had a lingering sense that little by little, the heat was stifling all will and all energy. We might lie this way for years, for who could be bothered to so much as twitch a foot or lift a head or turn the pages of a novel? Even thought, which never rests, was dulled, for who could be bothered to think? And there was no longer any need to listen for the whisper out at sea. Even our ears were shut now and then. The sound slipped by. We heard sporadically, a bumblebee buzzing perhaps, a gate slamming closed. I knew that a parrot hung in a cage in the middle of the sunny wall of the hotel. No doubt it felt its feathers grow warm, yearned to shift its bony old carcass. I could hear it grab the metal bars with its beak and swing. But then a gate slammed shut again, so hard this time that the hinges jangled. Shortly afterwards, I heard a voice close by me saying, "Do you see that?" What was there to see? For who could be bothered to lift their head? Then came the sound of footsteps from the road down below, hasty footsteps. It must be a man and a woman running. I could hear the tramp of the man's boots and the slap of the lady's skirts. I stood up, my eyes blinded by the immensity of the sun, which sparkled and shattered in the air. "Look there," said the white-clad lady by my side. She pointed, and through the blinding white apple trees, I now saw what was going on in the road. Three people were running. First came a quick little bare-legged lad. After him, a man no longer young, a local, dressed in blue shirt sleeves with a threadbare little straw hat in one hand. Last came the lady, one of the summer guests, but she was trailing far behind, hindered by her white dress. She tried to gather it up, but failed, and so she ran onwards, her frock flapping like a white flag. "Perhaps there's an angry bull," said the lady by my side. But that couldn't possibly be the explanation, because then the people would have no need to run as the gate was shut fast behind them. By now, all we sluggish summer folk had roused ourselves. Some stood up and raised a hand to shade their eyes. The runners were heading in our direction. A low fence separated the hotel grounds from the road. There was a small opening in this fence, with a wooden bar you merely had to push aside to pass through. The lad and the man reached it at almost the same time, but now the most comical thing happened. They were both in such a hurry that they got into a terrible muddle over this simple bar, fumbling at it and clearly quite confused as to whether they should jump over it, break it to pieces, crawl under it, or push it aside. And the sole result of all this fuss was that the lady in the white dress caught up with them. The lad proved to be the brightest of the three. He hopped over the fence a little further down, fell to his knees, got up again, and hurried towards us. Once the man was left to his own devices, he quickly managed to shove the bar aside. The three people reached us at almost the same time, and we could tell at once from their gestures that something strange had happened. But they were all too upset to be able to tell their tale straight away. The man, the local, sputtered intelligibly, his eyes bulging with fear, unable to find the words. The lady, quite out of breath, pressed her hand to her breast, but the lad was also quickest of speech. The lad was the first to tell the tale. It was still so early in the summer that only 6 or 7 holiday guests had arrived. Of these, 3 were ladies, who worked at a large company in Christiania, where staff holidays were portioned out among the employees from mid-May until late September. The summer season proper had not yet begun, but the ladies had to content themselves with taking their holiday whenever their turn should come. And then there were 4 of us gentlemen, an old bank clerk, a young student, a forestry inspector, and the writer of these lines. So far, we had been more than a little unlucky with the weather. Blustery by day, chilly by night, and overcast. But then one day, the summer flared up abruptly, heavy with heat and glowing with sun, and that is why the joy was so general. The idle well-being so pleasant on that morning, we were disturbed by 3 people running along the road. The little place where we now found ourselves was, incidentally, an exceedingly popular destination for summer guests, especially in July and August. A few short minutes' walk through a young spruce forest, and before us lay the sea. Far out there in the dark nights burned the beams of the lighthouse, flickering like northern lights across the sky. It was a fairly low landscape, an immense and somewhat rugged island. Very little of the land was cultivated, at least in the vicinity of the hotel, but a great plain stretched dozens of miles into its interior, a plain filled with heaps of rocks deposited by the moraine. Here and there, small tarns twinkled and riverbeds ran, and between them were marshy expanses overgrown with bushes and undergrowth. Far out on this plain lay Gyarne Farm, on a carpet of green, well-tended fields and lush gardens. By day, a glimpse of it was visible from the gable room of the summer hotel, and by night, from the same vantage point, lights could be seen twinkling in the windows of the farm. When I arrived at the hotel, I expressly requested the gable room so that I could enjoy the magnificent view across the plain at my pleasure. I knew the people on the farm from previous visits, a brother and sister called Carsten and Hilda Gyarne. Across the plain ran an old road that led with many twists and turns past the heaped rocks, around the tarns, over the brooks, and through the undergrowth and brushwood. A much favoured route for a stroll. It took you from the summer hotel to the farm in 30 minutes or so. Once there, an opportunity might arise to greet Hilda, who was young and beautiful, or strike up a conversation with Carsten Gyarne. And in both cases, the excursion could be reckoned a success. On the evening before the events I shall now recount, I had taken a walk across the plain. I left the hotel just after 9:30, once the evening meal was over. I was alone and walked with some haste, for the evening air felt chill and clammy. A little after 10 o'clock, I found myself close to the farm and thought there might be some sport in a conversation, a hand of cards or a game of chess with Carsten Gyarne. It was precisely the time at which he was in the habit of settling down in his study to fritter away the hours until midnight. I took it for granted that I would be welcome, since Carsten Gyarne was a man inclined to be sociable, and I knew him fairly well. But I must confess, I had another little hidden motive. What if Hilda had not retired for the night? Might I perhaps have a chance to exchange a few words with her? She was, as I have said, a very pretty girl. And here in this wilderness, I was feeling the lack of a woman's company. I found the 3 highly strung business ladies at the hotel quite unbearable with their constant prattle about whether they were growing fat or turning brown or whether I would like to accompany them to some spot where they could pick water lilies. I went through the garden gate and into the farmyard where the black dog Hector lay in his kennel. He growled and then, when I feigned not to notice, waddled out slowly, dragging his chain behind him. He kept on howling and growling, which caused me some puzzlement, for Hector had always struck me as a placid dog. As I was about to go through the front door, the farm steward came up and barred my way.
"Pardon me," he said, "the squire cannot be disturbed right now."
I stood staring at the man. "What is the matter?" I asked. "Are you ill?" The man was pale. I could see it despite the dim light. He stood there in the passageway, leaning against the doorframe. That could signify he was so weak he was close to collapse, but it could also mean that he would not let me pass at any price, and intended, by blocking the doorway, to show that I should not come by him.
"I am not ill," he said.
"Is your master ill then?"
"No."
"Does he have visitors?"
"No, he has absolutely no visitors. He is alone with his sister."
I did not entirely understand why I was being denied entry, so I continued with my questions.
"Can it be that I have caused him some offence?" I murmured. "Not at all," answered the steward. "But Mr. Gyarne cannot receive you this evening."
I looked at the man more closely again, by now quite convinced that he was indeed unusually pale.
I remember thinking then, why doesn't he ask if he can send his master my greetings, or whether I have come on some errand? I asked again, how did you happen to be out here in the passageway ready to meet me?
The mistress saw you coming.
Miss Hilda?
Yes.
And she asked me not to let you in. I'm here on orders. I turned abruptly and walked away. I did not take my leave of the man, did not so much as nod at him. I walked straight across the farmyard. The dog growled louder than before. There was a shortcut through the garden, a path I knew well. I had walked along it many times before, and I walked along it now. But then I did something which shows I had begun to nurse a suspicion that some peculiar business was afoot. I stopped in the darkness of the garden, beneath the cover of the trees, and stood there listening and looking over at the house. I could tell that the master had no guests, as the only lights burning were in the study and the room beside it. The light in his study was extinguished, and then lit again a couple of times. Just once, light winked in all the windows facing the farmyard when some person walked through the rooms with a lamp. It must have been Castiglione, as his room lay in darkness while this was happening. It was remarkable how much activity there was at the big farm. I listened tensely, and at one point it seemed to me that I heard unusually loud or excitable voices from within. As I stood there thinking that I should go, I saw one of the small side doors in the main building open. I knew this side door led into the mistress's apartment, into Miss Hilda's three small private rooms. Out of the door came a man in a green hunting jacket. He had a rifle under his arm, its barrel pointing downwards. He stood on the upper step and a woman came out too. It was Hilda. She held out a hand to him, smiled, and said a few words. Then he left, turned round to wave a hand, and she waved back. From my vantage point, I could see it all quite clearly. I knew the man in the hunting jacket well, a pleasant young chap who was staying with the rest of us at the hotel. He was a forestry inspector called Blinder. I found myself greatly interested, without being quite certain of the reason why. I stole around the back of a thick tree trunk because I did not want him to catch sight of me as I spied on him. Now Hilda had gone inside. She had plainly made no secret of escorting this man out. She had spoken so loudly to him that even I, standing towards the bottom of the garden, could hear her voice, although I was unable to distinguish the words, and she slammed the door, then turned the key with a click. A mere 10 paces away from me, the man stood and lit his pipe. His face glowed in the light of the match. He had a reddish-brown beard and firm, chiseled features. He threw the matchstick to the ground and trod on it. Then he turned his face into the wind as if to scent the air, a habit born of life in field and forest. He wanted to see what the weather was doing. Before going on, he tucked his hat further down over his eyes. Then he left. He took the path across the desolate plain towards the summer hotel. I waited a few minutes, for I did not want him to know that I had been spying. And then I followed. By the time I came out onto the plain, he had vanished beyond the nearest patch of marshland. I could no longer hear his footsteps, and no noise came from the farm. The wind had blown by and all was silent around me. It is odd to be out on such a plain on a summer's night. It becomes so endless. As the horizon disappears and the plain creeps up to meet the heavens, you cannot tell where the sky begins and the plain ends. In the blind half-light, the heaped boulders and rocky outcrops and, here or there, the occasional tree, assume strange and mysterious shapes. As I came over a stretch where the plain sloped down steadily to the sea, I felt a chill breath from the ocean and turned up the collar of my jacket. I looked out. I could see the ocean. The sea is always cool at night. I could hear the long swells rolling stealthily in and breaking on the shore. Ripples of shifting sand were blown along, and from these shifting sands protruded wretched, wind-blasted coastal pines, their canopies flattened and twisted inland like broken fans. I knew that this area was unsafe, that the occasional tinker sloop often came sneaking through the skerries by night, belly full to bursting, sails filthy and ragged, with superfluous poles trailing in the water behind it, and oars bristling. The sloop would settle on the rock like an insect, and then the tinkers would go ashore and raise hell among the lone souls that lived or wandered there. But I was not afraid. I simply remembered all this as I walked across the open expanse. I had a stout cane in my hand, an ivory-headed walking stick. I walked quickly onwards across the plain and buried myself in the shadows. Close by the summer hotel, The road ran through a little spruce forest. It was fairly dark here. I stopped in the middle of the wood as a peculiar sound reached my ears. What could it be? The noise came from a long way off, and I caught it only intermittently. It sounded almost like the rattling of metal links, a thrumming of chains some 10 miles distant. I carried on walking. I walked for 5 minutes and suddenly caught sight of something moving in the darkness a few feet away. Seeing at once that it must be a person, I tightened my grip on my cane and walked out in a wide arc. A man was standing there, a short man with a broad-brimmed hat on his head. I realized that if I walked any further, I'd have the man behind me, so I stopped at once. And as I stood there, motionless, the man came slowly towards me. Now that I recognized him, I began to feel ridiculous and regretted having taken a detour. I tucked my stick nonchalantly beneath my arm. At the same time, though, I couldn't help feeling pleased that the man was not somebody else, a stranger. He belonged to the place after all. I couldn't immediately remember his name, but he was a mild-mannered fisherman I'd spoken to often in the past. I said, "Out so late?" Instead of answering this profundity, the man cocked an ear to the sky and asked, "Do you hear that?" "What?" "Hush," said the man, listening. And now the sound came again. That infinitely distant sound of loose chains rattling. "What is it?" I asked.
"The iron chariot," the man replied gravely. "It's a long time since I last heard it."
The iron chariot. It occurred to me that I once heard about this, an odd tale to which I had paid little heed. I no longer remembered what it was, but the night and the darkness filled me with a sense that there was something eerie about it. Abruptly, I seized the man by the arm and walked alongside him. "The iron chariot," I asked. "How long is it since you heard it?"
4 years.
"It was the night old man Gyane died."
"Who owns the chariot?"
"Yes, indeed.
Who does own the chariot?"
the man replied and shook his head. I did not question him further, for now we emerged from the forest and the red-striped awning at the front of the hotel drove away all the atmosphere of the plain. And we could no longer hear the iron chariot either, since the forest lay between us and the plain, shutting out any sound. I went up to my gable room and opened both windows. The first thing I saw was a dim light twinkling far, far away. So the people at Gyane Farm had not yet retired for the night. Suddenly, I was interested in knowing when that light would be put out. I stationed myself by the window, but when I became tired of waiting, I paced back and forth across the floor, smoked a few cigarettes, then returned to the window, thinking, now the light must be out. But still it was twinkling over there. A whole hour passed. Then all at once I felt the night grow warm and muggy, and when I put a hand out of the window, a couple of heavy raindrops fell upon it. The air stood still, then the warm rain descended upon us, and the heat was pressed towards the earth. I listened and watched, and now I heard it again, this distant rattling of iron. But the sound was even further off than before. For long stretches, I couldn't hear it any longer. Then came a single, faint sound, followed again by silence. And then I heard the rattling for a minute or so. The iron chariot. I closed the windows. The sky outside was lightning. Somewhere, day must have crept over the mountains. I saw the trees become slimy with damp. A last glance across the plain, where the light burned still. I rolled down the blind. The true, stagnating, stifling heat of summer had arrived. It was the next morning that we 5 summer folk lay out on the grass, bathing in the sun and heat. It was then that the 3 people came running, the lad, the fisherman, and the lady in the white dress. They had something strange to tell us, but the lad was quickest of speech. He was the first to tell the tale. He said,
"We found a murdered man up on the road."